from the capital city of Charleston, West Virginia, this is Inside West Virginia Politics with Mark Curtis. Inside West Virginia Politics is brought to you by AARP West Virginia, your ally for real possibilities in the Mountain State.
Well, happy weekend, everyone, and welcome to another edition of Inside West Virginia Politics. I'm your host, Mark Curtis. This week, a reporter's roundtable as we wrap up the 2021 legislative session here in the Mountain State. Joining us from the Eastern Panhandle is a good friend of the program, reporter Brad McElhenney. He's the statewide correspondent for West Virginia Metro News. Good to have you on the program again, Brad.
Hey, good to have you. And it's been a couple of weeks since the legislative session, so now we are maybe a little more bright-eyed and bushy-tailed than we would have been last week.
Yeah, we have to do some of these, you know, shows virtually. I should remind folks that coming up on our third and fourth segment today, we'll have two other reporters in the studio to talk about the session as well. But first of all, I want to get your general impressions. Well, it was kind of weird having to cover this session the way we did. There was nobody in the Capitol.
Yeah, and you know, you and I were talking moments ago. I was there sometimes. I treated myself like a student on a hybrid school program. The access for reporters was during floor sessions, which is the main work of the entire each chamber individually. We were up in the galleries, and that is at a significant distance from usual. Usually, you're right down there with legislators. Oh, that's my dog making a debut on statewide television. But we were up in the galleries, and that was a little bit of a distance from previously. If it was baby dog, I'd put her right on.
That's the governor's dog. The governor likes to put his dog on during the press briefings. Here, who do we have here?
This is Bailey McElhenney, and like many people, I'm still working from home somewhat, and so the hazard of that is your dog may catch you on live or recorded broadcast.
Well, this is the first for Inside West Virginia Politics, and we welcome it. It's great to see Bailey. What might be considered the highlight of this session? You know, it was weird for me, too, the way we covered it, but we got it done. We did a lot of interviews out in the hallways with members of the House and the Senate. But what do you think, that if you had to write the headline of the big story of the year, what would it be?
Oh, my gosh. Well, you know, the overriding story of the year was one that seemingly went nowhere at the end. It was the governor's desire to make big changes to West Virginia taxes, a big income tax decrease offset by increased and expanded sales taxes. That oversimplifies it a little bit, but that gives you the gist. And the governor talked about that all the time, did town halls, went out to several areas of the state, gathered with groups of legislators, talked to people like you and me, made a real emphasis of it, and then the capstone on that was that 0 to 100 vote in the House of Delegates. They hadn't planned on doing that. They were just going to let it rest quietly. They did not buy into the tax shift. And so, but the governor essentially tempted them to take a vote, came out on the day before the end of the session and said he didn't think they had the guts to take a vote. And they said, well, tell you what, we will. And it was the only 0 to 100 vote I've ever seen. Very dramatic. That board lit up red. And it was a dramatic finish to the session, although TBD, there may be more to come.
Yeah, I was going to talk about that. To me, that moment, it wasn't necessarily 100 votes against the governor's tax plan. It was, in many regards, a defense of the honor of the institution of the House of Delegates. Roger Hanshaw, the speaker, we had him on last week, and he was, you know, he took great umbrage to the governor, you know, trying to tell the House how to conduct its business, and I think that was a unanimous vote on that regard.
The governor pushed back even after several times and called it grandstanding. But when I've talked to members of the House of Delegates, as I'm sure you have, they have considered standing their ground. They believe deeply that they represent their communities, that they had heard from their constituents, that there was a lot of not buying into this plan in communities. And they were standing their ground, in their view, as a co-equal branch of government.
You know, and it reminds me that the ad campaign, I don't think they saw that coming, too, from the West Virginia Broadcasters Association. In full disclosure, you and I are both members of that organization, although, you know, the decision to run those ads was done by our corporations and management. You and I had nothing to do with it, but it certainly was very effective.
It was challenging, but you know, there were so many groups: the West Virginia Broadcasters Association, the West Virginia Chamber of Commerce, the West Virginia Business and Industry Council, the West Virginia Beverage Association, even the West Virginia Farm Bureau, pushing back on what they perceived as the effects of this plan that would have raised sales taxes on the products and industries that they represent. So they collectively were not shy about pushing back. The governor called them out-of-state influencers, called them the swamp, called them the Charleston deep state.
We're talking with Brad McElhenney, statewide correspondent for West Virginia Metro News. We're going to have more with Brad in just a second. Let's take a break here on Inside West Virginia Politics.